Welcome back to second in the fall WyGISC Geospatial Forum series. Thanks for all being here, those of you that are in the room, and thanks to those that are joining online. Have my tech support here, and Cody, just want to make sure sound is coming through okay. Are you logged in, Cody?
Yeah. Jeff Paddington says yes.
Thanks, Paddington. and again, still kind of working out some of the bugs here with doing kind of a high flex sort of a thing, live in person, live streaming, recording, all of those different options. But hopefully it'll work out for everyone, and it'll be a good experience. For those that are online, I guess we'll do something similar that we did last time, in that we'll ask if you have questions to post in the chat, and Cody will be able to manage those at the end, and maybe just the same for in the audience that will hold the questions until the end. Just make sure we're recording, I guess, at this point. And admitting the last few folks. So just one real quick announcement, looking ahead. So we're doing these every 2 weeks. So our next speaker, again on a Wednesday, starting at 12:10 p.m. So October 26th will be a former WyGISC colleague, Jim Oakleaf, who's now at the Nature Conservancy. With their global conservation group, and his talk will be guiding a global conservation agenda with spatial data and tools. So mark down your calendar for that for 2 weeks from today. And so today, I have the pleasure of introducing Jacki Klancher. Jacki, I don't know how long we've known each other, but it's been a while.
Yeah, a decade at least.
A decade at least. And so it's great to have Jacki here. With us for today's forum. Jacki's a professor of environmental science at Central Wyoming College and also has an affiliation with the Alpine Science Institute. And we're really excited to have her here today, sharing a little bit with her experiences working with students and experiential learning in the field. So I'll turn it over to you. Welcome.
Thank you, Jeff. Thanks again. Being here. Yes, so I've been a professor at Central Wyoming College for about the last 15 years or so, and a few years into my teaching career, my whole life changed, and that's what I'm going to tell you about today. So as an educator in the classroom, you're constantly trying to create a circle of you give something and students meet you in the middle, and they give back and you get excited and you give some more. And when it's magic, you create a cycle of give and take that takes you to places you never thought you would go. And that's what happened with me in 2014, sitting in a classroom in a cold November day. And at that point, we launched into a combined field and academic program called the Interdisciplinary Climate Change Expedition. And we have been generously and graciously supported by EBSCOR, Wyoming EBSCOR, Wyoming Space Grant Consortium, and Wyoming INBRI over the years. And oops, I'm locked up there, Cody. Lost access. Oh, there we go. Hit the mouse. So over the next 30 minutes, I want to give you an overview of what the Interdisciplinary Climate Change Expedition is, where it took us, how we applied geospatial applications to learning in that, what we learned both from the science and from working with a group of undergrads that were new to science and new to field research and pretty tentative about entering into STEM, and some projects that we have on the docket for our next steps. I don't know if folks out there have seen the movie Chasing Ice. Has anyone seen that movie, James Balog's film? I strongly recommend it. Oftentimes as a professor, you feel like you're wasting time in the classroom if you watch a movie. It's sort of the standby of what the substitute does, right? James Balog's film explores placing time-lapse cameras throughout the world at the toe of glaciers. And Neil Humphrey, actually, from UW, created the cameras for that program. And Chasing Ice uses really strong aesthetics, but really gives a powerful message about climate change. So it was late in November, it was really cold outside. We decided not to go out. And we watched that movie, and just like the theater, nobody moved afterwards. Everybody sat sort of still with this hush of awe and a little bit of sadness about the hydrological, ecological, human, sociological implications of climate change. But really quickly, the wheels began to churn into inspiration and hunger for the chase. And these students said, well, could we do that in the Wind River Range? Could we put cameras out there? And the conversation and this circle I was referring to of students presenting ideas, we talk about co-production in the WIACT and the EBSCOR program, students giving ideas and me feeding off them. And within 45 minutes, we had a plan, and it went from, if we get not one little penny, this is what we'll do. And if we can find any grants out there with these amounts of money, this is what we will try and do. And we began the Interdisciplinary Climate Change Expedition with the idea of placing time-lapse cameras in the wilderness. Now, for anyone who's worked in wilderness, you're already seeing and hearing some warning signs and warning bells. Structures in wilderness are not a go. So the project evolved really quickly into other projects and other facets. But what it did was it lit a fire in that student group, which then passed to the next year and passed to the next year. And we've created sort of a culture around the Interdisciplinary Climate Change Expedition and its offshoots. So what was the goal and what is the goal of ICE? I've written our goal in 100 different formats for every different grant, but ultimately the goal was to get people on fire, to excite them about asking scientific questions, designing research methodology, presenting their data, and all the other skills really actually came afterwards. You've got the fire in the belly. It's amazing what you can do. So truthfully, what we wanted to use was our natural environment, the Greater Yellowstone Ecosystem, which is now expanded globally to other beautiful places around the world, to get students to essentially put the capstone first. Go out, ask questions, observe, apply the skills they had, and if they didn't have any, learn some, and then come back in the classroom. So the whole program lasts about a year with the in-class learning and formal classwork and lab work, and then a summer expedition. But really, if I were to sum it up, it's to create an inclusive, engaging, magic environment where students feel like they have stewardship over what they do, and they're on fire. They want to go and go as fast and as intently as I do. How do we evaluate the success of these expeditions? Were we inclusive? Did we not just build it and say, hey, if we build it, they'll come? Did we build it? Did we put up the welcome mat? Did we court? Did we ask? Did we invite? Did we embrace people of every realms and grade level at CWC and beyond? Do students learn something? This is a STEM program funded by NASA Space Grant Consortium and National Science Foundation. They need to demonstrate some knowledge that's increased from where they were at the end of it. Do they go on? Do they go on to a four-year university? So we track all these students and go, did we take students who had zero interest in STEM? Because initially when this all started, it was outdoor education students with no STEM confidence and zero STEM competence, at least outwardly. Many of these people actually had other courses and backgrounds behind them that gave them more confidence and more competence, or gave them more competence than they knew. But we were wooing them into this realm of STEM. So do they go on to a four-year institution? And for us, primary partner is UW. And or do they increase their employment opportunities? So really basic success measurement values, but also, did students have the time of their life? Did they leave that expedition and go, that was amazing, and I want to tell other people, and I want to go back? Are the students on fire from what we create for them? So where it all began, and I mentioned using the environment we have, the Greater Yellowstone Ecosystem, for us physically, if it began intellectually and creatively watching Chasing Ice, it began physically in the Fitzpatrick Wilderness on top of the Continental Divide on the Dinwiddie Glacier. The Dinwiddie's nicely tucked into the Fitzpatrick Wilderness, which means no motorized, no mechanized vehicles, horses only up to about 2 miles away from our work area, and 24 miles to our actual work area and 3 days of travel, plus some gear shuttling and a lot of logistics to get to the Dinwiddie Glacier. We chose that site because we already had an outdoor education course going in there and summiting Gannett, and they already had a connection. And the whole premise was, let's meet people where they're at. If they're on fire about summiting Gannett and we can get permitted to work in this area, let's start there. And we soon found out that for many, many reasons, the Dinwiddie was a critical area to be working. And we'll discuss that in a little more detail. But our initial environment for ICE was in a pretty spectacular location on top of the Continental Divide. Elevations for us tend to be around 11,000 when we're on the ice, and then 10,000-ish for a bunch of our camping and travel time. So why glaciers? Why climate? Why water? Well, if we think of the Dinwiddie, although it started as this captivating point, it's the glacier positioned underneath Gannett Peak, the Dinwiddie is a really critical water source for surface water for the Wind River Reservation, for Fremont County, and all the way out into the Missouri Water Resource Region. So roughly these days, 80 glaciers, it depends on whose count and whether they're named or not, and roughly 680 snow and ice bodies, and that is rapidly changing. Many permanent snow and ice fields that we thought were always there actually aren't, and then some are leaving and not coming back. But if we look at where this sits in terms of the Continental Divide and the impact, not only do we have the Missouri Water Resource Region on the eastern side, but we have feeding into the Green on the other side and the headwaters for the nation. So this little mountain range of little consequence that nobody really knows about, they've heard of Yellowstone, but they don't believe Wyoming exists, is the headwaters for actually three critical water resource regions. And many, many people don't know that the areas are glaciated, don't know that it's a problem, don't know that it connects to surface water. And if they knew, they probably would care. And if we go back in time, when we started doing this in 2014, the climate has changed, the atmospheric climate has changed, but the social climate has changed considerably since then. Then I still presented climate change in class with, I know you might have different thoughts on whether climate change exists or not. I began in that era, and now it's an entirely different approach. But then I also wanted students to see, observe, question, analyze, measure climate change internally through this expedition. And we readily moved on from, is climate change a thing, to everybody's on board and off we go. We're not explaining it anymore. But the Wind River Range, although little known by many, is a key source of surface water for not just Wind River Reservation in Fremont County, but the nation. So working in a glaciated region, it helps to have an interdisciplinary effort. So we took students who already had some wilderness risk mitigation skills and backcountry travel skills, and that's actually been really critical for us. We've tried to combine it all into one expedition. Work and travel safely in the backcountry, manage waste, keep your clothes dry, get up in the morning, be on time, participate in the group, think. It's too much. So we have a prerequisite course, which is either a course with the National Outdoor Leadership School or one of our two-week expeditions that just give people the experience working and traveling in the backcountry with other people. It's interpersonally really intense, gives them exposure to elevation, helps them just be able to stay warm and dry, keep track of their gear, et cetera. And that's been really critical for us. But when we look in respect to STEM, always at the core, whether we highlighted it a lot in our early years or not, which we did and we didn't. We used really advanced skills like ground penetrating radar, and yet some of our students were completely brand new to geospatial skills, but always within, always within our core were geospatial skills. So we used them not just to assess ice depth that mapped the perimeter on the glacier side, but we had a whole other team of high elevation archaeologists mapping sites and intently and intensely employing geospatial skills. From the environmental science realm, we were looking at water quantity, how much water is coming off the Dinwiddie Glacier, but we were also looking at water quality, and we'll just give a little more time to that in just a minute. We also looked at black carbon sampling. So whether it's from biofuels or oil and gas, particulate matter collecting in snow and ice can be collected and measured. And we wanted to see, would we see changes across years in high fire years? And we did have some lofty goals of trying to source that. And it's actually a little more complicated than we were able to tackle. But sort of a broad spectrum of these wilderness travel and leadership skills with the core of environmental science, water quality, water quantity, and geospatial skills. So given this crowd and WyGISC and the NASA Develop crew and many of you, what does it mean to do or perform applied geospatial tech in a wilderness environment? It's different than anything you can imagine. I have sat through many, many, many conversations about why don't you just fly a drone? Anyone who's worked with wilderness knows that that is unlikely to happen in the near future, not on my budget and in the, with the students with whom I roll. Maybe somebody else is going to get that kind of access, but it wasn't for us. So we looked at what can we do? Well, we can take an apple picker and put it on a long pole and rig it to a harness, and we can do laps of the Dinwiddie, and we can collect 6,000 photos and weave it together and pester Fabian all the time to get assistance with structure for motion and piece together a DEM of the Dinwiddie. We can have the time of our life with kite aerial photography and learn a lot about the fact that the wind is often completely calm in that core area that you see in the photo on the Dinwiddie. And we can accept with humility that it was a bust and we didn't get any great data, but we sure had fun. And it's still actually, even as a bust, enhanced students' geospatial vocabulary and their exposure. And then we worked with ground penetrating radar, and Andy Parsikian and Brad Carbon, both a great support in this. And we really, although qualitatively, having worked in that area for some 25 years, I could tell you areas we used to belay were now one rope length instead of two. We knew ice levels had changed, but qualitative assessment was not what we were looking for. We wanted something quantitative, so we made several efforts to work with ground penetrating radar and had a couple of particularly strong years working with Andy and some students here and a really strong student team to measure ice depth to bedrock. That GPR transect looks much steeper than it is there with the foreshortening, but this transect was of particular interest to us because it was based on a 2006 transect by Chisbrow et al. And so we had a foundation, even though with some horizontal error, we knew we weren't going to follow the line exactly. It gave us a place to start. And so we replicated that transect and have continued to do it across the years, some years more successful than others. So giving you a little insight into the expedition, emphasize the geospatial, the environmental, the hydrological, the glacial hydrological components of this. You have at least a taste of this group and where we work. What did we take away from this? What did we take away scientifically? What did we take away interpersonally, socially? Well, we learned a fair bit about the ice depth of the Dinwiddie, and we learned that our qualitative assessments were pretty bang on. And looking at ice depth from 2006 to 2016, ice depth approximate loss was about 13 meters. And if we were to look at that across years at 1.6 meters per year, or 1.3 meters per year, what we had observed out in the Dinwiddie is every year was certainly not the same. And when we've gone back over time, we can assess through somewhat for the geomorph folks in the room, visually by the ice pedestals. We haven't exactly correlated those to the ground penetrating radar, but almost to the T on a big ice year, you'll see a 2 meter pedestal, you'll see a 2 meter esker at the base of the glacier, and you'll see 2 meters of new debris. And on a year when we only lose a foot of ice, we see according pedestals across the whole glacier. I had not seen anything published on this until very recently, and I'm really curious and eager to expand what we've seen on the Dinwiddie. But the fun in that is then we can take GPR and assess it quantitatively, and then we can do a loose quantitative slash qualitative with the pedestals and compare and contrast. And it also gives some elements and avenues for engagement by community scientists and hikers to go, boy, pedestals this year, 2.5 feet consistently across the whole glacier, because they are pretty consistent. We have lots more to do with that, but it's a new area we're exploring. And this is an example of these ice pedestals. If for us, if one is 2 feet, almost all of them are 2 feet. Now, depending on the time of year, you're going to lose some accuracy, but there's somebody's graduate master's degree or their late undergrad thesis. We also wanted to make sure students had at least basic functional use of GPS to GIS integration. And although measuring the terminus of a glacier, as we know they flow, and assessing where it comes to and where it moves across years is not an accurate way to assess if a glacier is advancing or receding. In this case, this glacier is receding in depth and receding in overall area, and it is doing so drastically. And the signs of this are the two gigantic lakes that have formed at the terminus of the Dinwiddie. It is going, but as an activity and as a way to just help introduce students to basic geospatial data management, we walked the perimeter, and that's when we first started seeing the pedestals. We see moulins appear and disappear, and you see this really dynamic environment when you spend time on the ice. And so comparing across years, we go back to the light blue in 2014. And again, this is, I wouldn't rely on this as my only source, but I can almost guarantee the next time we go up and map the terminus that there'll be a nice solid jump up from our most recent, which was, I think, in this one, 2018. So when the glaciers go and we use these geospatial tools to assess them and hydrologic tools, what are the implications? Well, they're huge. So water that is stored in this reservoir that's running off provides a savings account. The balance, the interest goes downstream. What happens when you turn on a tap and there's full force and then half force and then 10 drops? As long as there's always something, you have something coming out of the tap. When these glaciers are gone, when you turn on that tap metaphorically, now there's nothing, and you can't do anything with nothing. If we're not storing ice and water up high, now we have surface water coming down through precip, yes, but this whole system is being transformed by the loss of the savings account. So if we live check to check each month versus we have a savings account that provides steady interest, it's a whole different level of hydrological or financial security. So when I mentioned these large lakes at the terminus, these are significant both in terms of where the water is. So we're creating big lakes at the terminus that are new and growing. It also creates the possibility of insecurity about how secure the boundaries of those lakes are in terms of glacial outwash floods. And I'm not, that's well out of my area of expertise, but we have watched those increase massively. And then it draws our attention to what's available down below once we lose the ice and we lose the snow on top as our savings account. And in the backcountry, as part of our environmental science, we wanted to assess, are we as researchers having an impact through waste management or wilderness travelers in general? So we did a lot of work on water quality, looking at macroinvertebrates, E. coli presence and absence, and creating a more of a, I suppose, an Imbri realm microbiological project on the side, which we have done across the years. So what have we learned? We've learned a fair bit quantitatively. We've also learned a lot about our students and what interdisciplinary means. So this photo is from an Eastern Shoshone student, Antoine Day, who has entered our world as a researcher this spring when we went on an expedition to Everest, and has started to have a natural bend towards backcountry research, but who's taking his work and creating a number of STEAMs, so science, technology, engineering, arts, and math, artist representations of the places we work. So we've learned a lot about interdisciplinary, and although over the years, everyone always asked, well, you know, have you thought about doing poetry? Have you thought about doing writing? Like, boy, I'm just trying to keep everybody safe on the glacier, and we have food, and we have horses, and we have money. I would hear it and I would nod, but inside I was thinking, are you mad? You have no idea what my life looks like. But Antoine's brought a new element to our work and we're grateful to him. So we've learned a lot about the interdisciplinary nature and including the arts and creating a niche for our arts-oriented students to shine. We've also learned that we can do so much more when we partner. So in 2019, we launched ICE Tanzania. So that was EPSCoR, NASA Space Grant, CWC Foundation, and NOLS. And through that, we started really trying to help create a niche for our Eastern Shoshone and Northern Arapaho students. And what we asked of them was a bit spectacular. We are trying to do better then, but you see Jada Antelope, the first Northern Arapaho woman on the top of Kilimanjaro. And we wove in STEM through sampling of the microbiome and through basic geospatial data use, collecting points, creating story maps, creating maps. And this is not something we could have done on our own. It took a village. While we were up there, you can see the true nature of a partnership there. There's Sarah Conrad doing all the work. And I think I'm reading the instructions, or I'm telling her I'm cold or I have to pee. But we in turn worked with a researcher who wanted to have us retrieve a weather station SIM card. And apparently it gets a bit windy on the top of Kilimanjaro. So we took all of these interdisciplinary desires of geospatial, glaciology, hydrology, microbiome, combined them with wilderness backcountry travel, and really upset the apple cart and took a couple of students from Wind River to East Africa with us. And just really, I guess, hits home what you can do when you have a village. And on that, we also learned some really deep and philosophical points about diversity, equity, inclusion. And I think so often when we design programs, what we want is we want 100 people, and we want to give everybody $100, and it's all going to be great. And that isn't how it goes. It takes actually a ton of love, a ton of time, and $100 is not even a little teeny band-aid if you're trying to welcome someone into a world that seems completely inaccessible. So designing welcoming, meaningful, and safe, and I say that because Tanzania was pretty bold. We asked a lot of our Eastern Shoshone and Northern Arapaho students to swing on over to East Africa and roll with 8 other Ivy League students. And the only reason it worked so well is because Africa upset everybody's apple cart. This student had a tick in her eye, and this one had nonstop diarrhea. And this one amazingly could pick up Kiswahili in a heartbeat. And so somehow Africa worked as the leveler. Do I recommend that you put in one person who's different? No, give people a village, for heaven's sakes, if you can. But our students really have rallied for us, and we've really tried to do our best to serve the creation of a community, as diversity, equity, inclusion rarely is one. That's a lonely place to be. So we now have Jada Antelope, who's in that Mario shirt, who's been to East Africa. She's been on 3 other expeditions with us. She's coming again this summer. Now she's working as staff, and her sister wants to come. And her girlfriend's in the picture. And Alex is going to be in the NASA Develop Program, this guy right here this spring. And bit by bit, by gentle bit, we're building our village. And I'm very grateful to the students who hung in through our earliest attempts where it's like, all right, y'all, we got the money, we got the ticket, we're going to Africa. Bless them for having hung in, but we all were sort of off our game. And why does this matter if we bring this back to glaciers and water and Wind River Reservation? Well, for our Eastern Shoshone and Northern Arapaho students, they want so badly to serve the reservation and their tribes, but the opportunities are not always available on the reservation. So we're opening the door, and I'm not saying, listen, I can provide everything you need culturally or intellectually or academically. I'm saying I can give you a few skills. And if you work within your tribe, with your elders and your community to bridge that culturally and give it meaning, we can move this whole ship forward together, and you will have the skills to go back to the reservation and serve people and place and the elders and the next generations coming along. So we went from ice, which was our, it was our core forever, to, well, if that worked so well, geospatial opportunities are everywhere. Let's get these students biking and let's put them on bikes on the Great Divide mountain bike route in Eureka and have them bike to South Pass City. Let's train them up. Let's provide mountain biking classes. Let's provide intro to GIS. Let's teach them about air quality, and let's get some portable air quality meters, and let's put them on these students. Everyone connects to the land. They learn some environmental science. They gain some data, and then we process that data, and they learn something academically. And so BIKES, Broadening Inclusion, Knowledge, and Experience in Science, was predominantly actually Eastern Shoshone and Northern Arapaho students, but it was a mix. But it wasn't just one Eastern Shoshone student or one Northern Arapaho. I'm like, you've got a cohort now. And now we all work together on this. And for anyone who says biking, oh, that's such a farce. She's just using this as a way to have fun. My God, this is our life. Let it be fun. What does BIKES teach students? Well, they didn't know what nitrogen dioxide was or how that, how ozone related to volatile organic compounds. They didn't know how to take a CSV and put it into ArcGIS Online and to move data back and forth from Pro to a story map. They learned a lot. A couple of them learned to program a little to make the data match up on the timestamp and learn things. They quickly left their mentor behind. So these expeditions are, and the learning that happens, are what you dig for and you create. And it doesn't, in my opinion, denigrate the experience academically if people have fun, get fit, explore an environment for our Indigenous students that was their land, that forces them to be in a good mood when they're grouchy and they've been biking and they're in a group living situation. That's part of life, and academia is part of life. From there, we went to, okay, hiking is not purely recreational. We know there's significant recreational impacts of backcountry travelers. We partnered with the US Forest Service and EPSCoR and NASA and IMBRI. We measured dissolved oxygen. We did qualitative observations for harmful cyanobacterial blooms. And students engaged Survey 123, ArcGIS Online, ArcGIS Pro. They expanded significantly in just the course of a few weeks, quote unquote, just by going hiking. And they explored a landscape. And they spent some time in spectacular places. And they were inspired. And they're back. They're back with us for this summer. What else did we learn? Scientific storytelling is not intuitive. So I don't know when other people created their first research poster. For me, it was graduate school, which is also where I developed my first hypotheses. And we flipped that around and said, that's crazy. These are smart students. They can start asking questions and developing hypotheses as freshmen. This is not actually rocket science. And you can't just assume that people know how to create a poster. So we turned it into a class. It's like, for heaven's sakes, let's guide them. Why does this have to be so difficult? We had faculty spending early mornings and weekends and running around like crazy. And finally, we just went, this is legit. This is a skill in academia. Let's train our faculty. Let's train our students. And let's turn it into a course. Don't forget the basics. So we used ground penetrating radar. We did structure from motion. We used quantitative and qualitative and all kinds of ways to assess the dinwiddie. Never forget the power of a photograph, and never forget the power of basic route finding and topographical map use if you're training people to work in the backcountry. So our ice glacier repeat photo expedition was glaciers throughout all of the winds, finding spots that had been completed by Mark Meyer in the 1950s and repeating those, and then putting it together in story maps and really focusing on some skills that are starting to be lost, which is just basic map and compass, wilderness travel skills. And just for fun, Dinwiddie Glacier in 1951 on the left, and now. So the Forest Service would argue, pretty obvious it's decreasing. Why do we need to keep measuring it? I would argue there's lots of other implications that we can inform science and modeling and communities that are not just a direct quantitative measurement of ice loss. The lakes I referred to are down here. These are yet bigger, bigger, bigger. And for the ecologists in the room, it blew my mind when we started finding Engelmann spruce right up at the toe of the glacier. Why? Because there's whiskey jacks and there's martens and there's porcupines and there's badgers at 10,300 feet and there's pikas on the top of Gannett. So are there more implications to just losing the ice than the ice is gone? There's huge implications. And as we get close to wrapping up here, the need for data and information needs are global. So Dee and I were talking about your Nepal project. So when we were in Everest, the problems that are plaguing one quarter of the world's population with available surface water for drinking are the same problems we have here through glacial ice loss. We have concerns in the Andes about getting accurate weather stations that can assess weather and climate over time. And this isn't just a Wyoming problem or an Andes problem or a Chile problem or a Tibet problem or a Nepal problem. This is a global problem. And in the winds in particular, for those who've worked in wilderness, there aren't any fixed weather stations. We have snowtail sites in some subalpine regions. They are sparse and they are meant to be where there's lots of snow. What we don't have is anything above tree line assessing weather, air quality as well, and over time climate. We learned there's no limits. If we have global problems, let's expose students to global problems, but give them a core of skills. So in April of 2022, we took the team that you've seen in these pictures to Everest. We tested some new sensors. We worked with the first all black and brown expedition, the full circle Everest expedition, and our students spent a couple nights at base camp with them. They did not summit Everest, but nobody seems to care. I'm like, y'all, it's base camp. They're like, doesn't matter, just say you went to Everest. And if we think back to the student whose art you saw in January, he will do a full artist representation of his work from Everest and weave it in with a presentation that those students will do, and the village moves forward. What's coming up? Climate capture, community-led initiative to monitor alpine temperature extremes, tech that exists, tech that we're developing, Penn State University, Minnesota, Space Grant Consortium, Medio Tracker from Italy, Shannon, who we look to, and Sam now for everything data to help us store and take data to information to inform knowledge. Data, 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 data is nothing if we don't do something with it. So our next project will be some crazy acronym that I'll come up with probably on top of climate capture, but we'll engage hikers from the Continental Divide, hikers on the High Line, students from the University of Wyoming and Central Wyoming College, Alpine Science Institute. And we try and bridge the gap between those who feel completely disconnected from science and climate change by giving them access to hopefully a closing gap between science and the community. Looking at those routes, we have CDT hikers coming down on the Bridger-Teton side. We have the high route hikers, a pretty technical route about 100 miles from Dubois. And then we have this team here, which is the team that's been with us in bikes in Nepal and East Africa at this point, called New Voices, who will be exclusively actually for this project, American Indian Indigenous team that will hike the Continental Divide, still participating in science and then creating some podcasts and documenting their journey. And together we cross the divide from purely classroom to classroom and field integrated, from ice to water, from bikes to hikes to climate to across projects, keeping the STEM core solid. And we build a diverse, equitable, an inclusive community of competent and confident STEM researchers who have opportunities to bring their own skills and their own artistic and other life skills to the program, and we go forward. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Jacki. Always inspiring.
Oh, thank you. Are there some, do we have
really
time for
great.
Any questions?
We have, we've got 7-8 minutes for questions. So in the audience.
So I was wondering if you had done anything 3D with all of your great photogrammetry and your structure from motion?
Not yet.
Oh, can I help?
Yes, please. Yes, please. I think I either gained some neuronal capacity or shut down about a third of my brain weaving together all those photos to get to the point where we actually had representative elevations. So please do. We would love to partner and would love to move this data forward and create something more informative from it. What is your name?
Margo Aronson.
I think we met at many years ago. Boy, sorry, nice to see you again. Yes, would love to. Other questions? Yes.
Actually, I have a comment, same thing. I know it's probably heartbreaking to have like a data set that didn't work out, like photogrammetry, but I think it might be a good lesson in of itself, because like this, I don't know, it's happened to me and it's hard to like accept, you know, like, oh, well, of course I can do something with these images, but then maybe like the data set wasn't right for whatever reason. You just gotta go back out there. That's a tough lesson.
Exactly. It's just part of it. And we've applied for some grants where the turnaround is really quick for, you know, you apply and we want this project on climate change wrapped up in the summer. And can you be ready to present in October? I'm like, boy, we'll be lucky if we get the sensors by then. And then we got to test them and see if they work. And then we have to see if we actually have anything. And it's all part of the process. And in terms of learning, it's never a bust. Yeah. We always learn something. Some years, once you're already 5 days into the expedition and you realize, this is a bust, the batteries for the GPR are dead. It's disappointing, but that's part of being a good sport on the planet, right?
Yep.
Yeah, there's one question in the chat. Jed Anderson asks, have you looked at pushing any of these ideas to the high school level?
We did explore the high school. We took my kid, my colleague's kid, and their best friend in the field. We have, and we would love a high school liaison to perhaps come at this with the intense fervor that I have. It's a whole different world with minors, and it is a whole different world working around their school schedules. So I did it. I went to the high school and integrated myself into their life, but I think it needs somebody, a bigger community. The village would need to expand, but there's that, I think it's called Girls on Glaciers or something. There's a program in Alaska. There is potential and it can be done, but it takes another strong colleague. And in truth, dealing with minors and sharing tents, like there's just some nuts and bolts things in terms of all kinds of risk management that you have to think of with minors. But absolutely, that's our next generation, right? So I'm not opposed to it. And I have dabbled. It nearly killed me, but I dabbled. And we got posters to undergraduate research day for all of those. They were all freshmen and sophomores, actually. So it was a push.
Another question from Paddington. How do you know if students are improving their foundational knowledge and skills in GIST?
That is a great question. Some of it is not done through surveys and questions. It's, all right, we meet on Fridays. Let's make the story map together. Let's do things together. So do we have another person within our grants who does the qualitative assessment of all of their learning? Not yet. We have a new grant that's going to demand that. Truly, it happens through us continuing to follow up and with this really small cohort of me upping the ante and asking more of them. So it's really personal, it's really energy intensive, and it would never cut muster in a huge grant program, but it works for us because I know where they're at and it's a small enough cohort. So we just keep upping the ante and adding more classroom and more responsibilities in terms of presentation.
So I'm familiar with like, I guess the remote programs like the Juno Ice Field Research Program. And so I was kind of wondering like, do you see this as a model for more like local based research that universities can provide?
You know, I see it as a model for super creative applications of integrating physical activity and wilderness travel with STEM It is tricky in Wyoming because our wilderness and forest service areas are heavily, heavily permitted. So in terms of working in environments like this, the Greater Yellowstone is really unique and it's super rugged and the risks are real. It creates a model in-house for us to design other things around it. And I think it creates inspiration for other programs, but I think they have to find maybe their thing is on a sailboat assessing microplastic contamination or working with climate buoys or something like that. I think not every place has access to this environment, and we sort of have a pretty specific faculty crew that came to this. So it is a model for something, but with adjustments. Did that answer your question?
No, that's a thing.
I'll ask one. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead,
please.
So how do you choose the timing to go out to the field to do the studies?
Happily, the nature chooses that for us. We need to be out in July and August. The most of the snow is off the glacier in August. That means we don't have to rope up to travel. When we are out there earlier in July, anytime we're crossing glacial ice that's snow covered, we have to rope up in an upsea intensity. And by rope up, I mean create a team all secured so you can rescue someone from a crevasse if you need. So we choose the time when in-service is happening at the college, when you have the meetings and the intense business aspect of the college, to be our field time because it works really well. But in the winds here, it's really specific to when the ice is clear and there's not a bunch of new snowfall to travel over rock fields in September, October. So it's a pretty tight field season, just kind of July and August is it.
Do you admit students from other areas like who would love to come and go for the field trip, even if they're not in the same institution? Like
we sure do. We sure do. We have, in fact, a lot of our students come here and then come back and continue on the expedition. And then some of them start to come back as staff. And we have definitely cross-pollinated with students from University of Wyoming. Like, let's say you were here for the NASA Develop Program and studying GIS, and you really wanted to learn more about this. We would want to start communicating. And you just have to get some prerequisite field travel experience through one of our other programs so that we're not trying to teach everything all at once in the field, because that blows everyone's mind, including mine. So yes, welcome.
Thank you. I'll just ask one. So what's your position on allowing drones for science in wilderness areas and national parks? Is there value there that should be considered?
It depends on how caffeinated I am and how badly I think we could really, how badly I want it. Truthfully, I've turned it into a battle that is not mine to fight. I'm working around it in creative ways that expand skills, create community, and there's a whole planet full of places we can use UAVs. If I was 100% certain that the science we, that the data we would contribute would absolutely transform or really enhance or change climate or hydrological science, and I could say that with conviction, I would lay it down to the mat if I really thought that. At this point, they flew LiDAR all over all the winds, I think it's 2 years ago, and I know that data is there. I think I'd let that battle go. I really wanted the repeat photo cameras. I was crushed. And there was a typo in the letter from the Forest Service. He said, you can put them. And then we met him in person. He's like, oh, I forgot the knot. You can't put them. But that was very disappointing. I chased him down the road and I'm like, here's the email. And he's like, I forgot the knot. I'm like, it's just my hopes and dreams and all those 20 students. Thanks. But it was a honest mistake. So if the merit was really strong, yes, otherwise, community science, structure for motion, physical, qualitative. I've decided to focus my energy on things I can change and I can move forward.
Well, I think we're about out of time. So let's thank Jacki once again.
Thank you, everybody.
Hopefully we'll see you all in 2 weeks again.
Have a good afternoon.